Okay, und wir beginnen, ich sehe gerade von der Regie, dass wir schon mit dem nächsten und letzten Themenblock jetzt schon starten werden. Da werden wir einen kleinen Ausflug auf die europäische Ebene noch einmal machen. Wir gucken uns an Lessons learned aus von COVID-19. And we will switch to English for this session, because we have two English-speaking guests with us. So I'm saying, say welcome to Ovia Maria from the Israeli Ministry of Health. I hope I see you in Tel Aviv. Hello. Hello from Berlin.
Hello. Yeah, thank you.
Yes, here it's already dark outside, so I am not sure how the weather is or like how the sunset is in your country right now. And I also say welcome to Annemarieke Alnius. I hope I pronounce your last name right. Otherwise, you can correct me later. You are the director of the Swedish eHealth Agency. Welcome from Berlin to you too. Thanks for joining us here tonight. Right, this afternoon. We had a whole day of discussions about how the data is changing well, the healthcare system in Germany and in Europe, especially under those pandemic situation we're having here today. So it's also the first day in Germany we have this kind of lockdown here. And so I'm it's really nice to at least have you here as a digital guest. So Israel and Sweden are fighting the pandemic in several and different ways, and we have all the same challenges. And I really, if we were looking especially at the digitalization strategy or technologies, maybe you could give both of you could give us an insight what your governments all try to do in technology reasons or digital strategies. So maybe we look at Israel first. So what steps did the Israeli government take in the pandemic, looking at technologies?
Right. First of all, again, thank you for inviting me to speak in the symposium. I think it's a really good, even though I didn't fully understand every single German word that was mentioned a few minutes ago, but I think the whole concept of talking about digitalization and digital health in this time of COVID, but also before it, but and after, is something that all countries and all organizations must commit themselves towards. And I think that that is the number one lesson to be learned from this time, because and if you want, I can elaborate on the different actions that we in Israel were already taking into consideration during the COVID pandemic. But I think that the most important thing is that we had a lot of things to that were already implemented before this time. Our national strategy from 2015 for digital health, our national program for digital health as a growth engine for the country, over 1 billion shekel, which is roughly 300 million euros for 5-year plan, and many other issues that were already taken into consideration when we came to the pandemic. But of course, the foundations and the building blocks are good to move you forward, but they're not enough. And I think that one of the major understanding that we saw right at the beginning is that this unique kind of data understanding, utilization of it for the primary care, but also for the policy drafting and crafting during the time of COVID was super important, and we could not have utilized it without it, and we couldn't tackle COVID without it, and that with innovation and tech integration and monitoring and prediction and telemedicine, of course, which is a major thing today during the world, is something that emerged during COVID and saw that we have to utilize digital health in order to combat the disease. One important thing to also mention is that a digital health alone is not enough, meaning that without the infrastructure, the hospitals, the caregivers, the personnel on the ground, nothing can really happen. And digitalization and digital health are something that are helping us to promote new and innovative ways in order to treat the disease and, of course, healthcare in general. I would say, again, if we're only in opening remarks, and maybe later on I can elaborate on that, I think that once we, and we're not at the end of it, hopefully, when the vaccination comes into place and we're going to see a bit further on from day to day. I think one of the most important things that we did was to, first of all, immediate measure taken to act to prepare our healthcare system for the next pandemic wave. We just finished our second lockdown and a second wave just a month ago, and we are trying to prevent a third one from happening. We have to learn and utilize every single piece of data and understanding and research capability that we have. We have to interact with the public. We have to understand their current models are working or not, and how to create a new and better models. We have to adjust our policies, our practice, our cooperation, our agility, our measures. And later, and finally, we have to allow new and innovative technologies and methods to incorporate in order to enable the ecosystem. And then repeat and repeat and repeat. We have to act, we have to learn, we have to adjust, we have to act over and over again, utilize everything we already had, and then elaborating on. I'm not sure if that completely answers your question, but I think that's like the main event we in Israel are.
Well, yeah, it was a good answer, but I was missing a little bit the examples. Maybe you could give us like one very practical example. Would you say where would you say technology helped or should help in the future?
Okay, I can give you maybe two examples, even though you asked for one. I think first of all, I think is the data usage. And what we saw is that, first of all, we had to gather the data from all different specific points, from the hospital, from the laboratories, from the people themselves, and then to create a dashboard, of course, for the public, but also for policymakers. That's the first thing that we did and invested our time in, to create something that can understand the situation on the ground regarding tests, regarding cities that are more hurt by the disease or not, how to create the different measures and et cetera, to collect, to analyze, and then enable towards the solution. The second thing, and I'm going to give it the broad spectrum, is, of course, telemedicine and the utilization of it. And we were fortunate enough to, even before COVID, to enable a new regulation that enabled telemedicine within the Israel Access and to create a reimbursement program that were already in place. But I think what was most interesting that we did was to create a new telemedicine community. Basically, we took almost 400 health workers from different sectors, from oncology and pediatric and neurology and many other fields, and connecting them together with the help of tele video conferencing, etc., to talk about the different challenges, to talk about the different opportunities, to see how they're actually doing telehealth in real life, and then to promote a better way to create those. So to understand that this is a new world, we have to adjust, and we have to create the entire ecosystem in order to adjust with us, with it. Health workers, with the public, with the government, with the HMOs, and everyone else. And I think those are maybe two specific examples. And if you want, I can elaborate on each one of them.
Yeah, well, thank you. At this stage, thank you for those two examples. I think we could all imagine what you're doing there. I actually want to put now the look to Sweden and looking at technologies and a digital strategy to fight the pandemic there. Maybe you can give us some insights what Sweden did with especially on technology and digital strategy to fight the pandemic.
Yeah, thank you very much. My name is Annemieke Olenius. I'm from the Swedish eHealth Agency. And as you notice, I'm sitting on my ceiling, which I've been here since March. All our whole agency has been remote working since March. So that's one of the ways we are handling the pandemic in Sweden. We are very much those who can work from home, do so and study. Something which became very clear here in Sweden is that we have a very good digital infrastructure. So a lot of people could work from home, shop from home. We have e-prescriptions, which are all digital, which I know you're working on in Germany, but that made it also possible to order your prescriptions by, for example, pharmacies on the internet. But as my Israeli colleague also mentioned, a lot of the tools that were used now during the pandemic were already in place before the pandemic. We have a national patient portal, for example, where you can have order your appointments, you can read your medical records, you can check your test results, for example, and at this national patient portal, you could do a self-assessment if you think you would have COVID, and you got some recommendations. If they thought you had COVID, you could order a test kit, which was transported to you at home by a taxi. You take the test yourself, and it was transported back to the laboratories. Something which we also noticed was that before the pandemic, the most users at the National Patient Portal were younger ones, but now it has increased, the number of elderly have increased enormously, and during this first half of year, for example, more than 400 citizens that are elderly than 100 years, they have logged in this digital patient portal. So we had a lot of things in place for the patients or for the citizens themselves. And we also had, we have in Sweden 104 national quality registers. One of the registers which was very good to use is the Swedish Intensive Care Registry. That registry we are using now to keep track on the availability of beds on the intensive care units, and also the occupancy in the EUC. So we are using very much what we had in place, but we're using it in a larger scale, and a lot of the people in the population have discovered these possibilities.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think this morning we discussed already about this intensive care document we have in Germany. We also have had one of those things build up and out of nowhere, kind of. And but the next thing I really want to talk about you is about those tracing or tracking apps. There was a huge discussion in Germany what to do with how to build it, how to set it up, and now 23 million are using this app. Maybe you tell us a little about how the discussion about those tracing or tracking apps were in your society or your governments. And we will start again with Israel.
Great, thank you. I think that's really not an easy question. It's not an easy question because, first of all, I think no one model has managed to rise from all. And I think most countries, even today, even 10 months from the beginning of the pandemic, the world pandemic, are still struggling to understand which is the ideal model of contact tracing and how to utilize it. I think what we tried in Israel to do is to create a dual process. For one, to create something that is designed with privacy in mind, that it's enabling the user, that it has a lot of impact within the user, that in his cell phone, that an app that we've developed, the Shield, Hamagen in Hebrew, which can utilize your own services in order to see where you were and to only share data if you choose to do so. Now, this is good if you've got enough of the people that are actually utilizing the app, which was still till today, even though the app is up for 6 months, is still not in the critical mass that we needed to. So in that perspective, we also utilize different mechanisms in order to create a contact tracing mechanism to allow us to help the people to for them to disclose the places that they were in. And we are always in a constant balance between the privacy and the public health. And I think that no matter what you do, you're gonna hurt one or the other. And you have to keep those elements in check once you look at the contact tracing. And another very important thing is that the person view, the people that are actually doing the contact tracing are gonna have to be always in the process, no matter how big or how small your cases are in the country. I think that those are very big and important elements to incorporate within it.
Thank you very much for that. I think we have had have this discussion in Germany still going on. After I think in June it was presented to the public, you could download it, and since then we still have these discussions going on if it should be able to do more and or do less. So I think this discussion will be continued. In Sweden, how was this discussion about tracking or tracing app was going on? How did the society talk about it?
Well, we don't have any track and tracing app in Sweden, and that's because our national authority for public health has made the decision that we should solve the pandemic in a different way. So there is no app in Sweden, and there are no discussions about it either. There are some discussions, but they're not very, very high. We follow all the work that is done by the European Union, and we are also following very much on what Germany has done, and Germany has also been building the European Federative Gateway Service in order to keep track of people who are moving around the borders if they are contaminated by or if they have the virus. But in Sweden, we have another recommendation from our expert authorities. So, but we are following what the other countries are doing. And as my Australian colleague said, I haven't noticed any country yet that has reached the amount of downloads that are needed to have real use of the apps.
Yeah, I think that's true. I would actually, I would say that's the point, that the apps are maybe even expensive in the process of in the process of making this app, but they will they're still not in the use like they should. So, what would you say we should actually think about if in the next pandemic would come? What kind of technical tools or technologies we should have for the society and for the healthcare? So, what do you think? What will be the lesson learned out of this pandemic right now for the next one, which may come in 2, 5 years, 10 years, maybe never? But I think there will be one.
Yes, there will certainly be one. That can we be sure about. We do not know when it will come. But what we have learned is that we should work better with the elderly. We were, as many other countries, too late to work with the nursing homes and to keep track on the elderly. The absolute largest part of the deaths in Sweden due to COVID are people elderly than 70 and or 85 plus. That's the real big group, and some of them have been living in these nursing homes who got really, they got, it was bad in some of them, so that's something which we should be looking after better. I think it's important to use digital solutions, but we should choose the solutions that have the trust of the people, because if they lose trust in digital solutions, then they maybe also lose trust in solutions we definitely don't want to lose. So we have to be very careful.
And to you?
I think I agree completely with my colleague here, but just because I think that, again, we need to think a bit about it as a holistic solution that would encapsulate everything that we can with the people, with the organizations, with the government, and to see it in a very holistic view. I think one thing that also connects to the tracing app that we need our local engagement. We need the understanding with the local government and with the local city halls and etc. because they know the land better than the general government. Even in a small country like Israel, which is much smaller than Germany or Sweden. So I think that's also important. I think one understanding is that digital health is here to stay. If before COVID, we talked about the telehealth and telemedicine as something that we are trying to incorporate and to inject to the industry and to the organization, now it's something that is almost, it's there. There's no other way to escape it. However, there is a real challenge to make sure that this 10-year leap in 5 months or 6 months is going to stay. And that's a very important thing that now after the current waves, we're going to have to create a lot of efforts in order to maintain those strategies. I think one important thing is to have a national strategy regarding digital health implementation through the entire ecosystem. Again, organizations, health organizations, HMOs, industry, academia, public engagement, public understanding, of course, other governmental entities, and to create something that's going to act fast, adjust, and act again, learn and adjust and act again. And I think that's the most important thing regarding our lesson learned. And if I would say just one more thing, I think data is the key. And we all know it. Everyone who's dealing with digital health, regardless of your position or your country, you always talked about data as the main resource that you've got into to incorporate within the organization. And I think now digitalization, digital technologies, the new innovative technologies integration within that, utilizing them on a national scale, on a local scale, that's the main agenda that we have to continue on and investing in. And we don't know which pandemic is going to come, and we don't know which technology is going to come. And that's the nice thing about it, because we're always evolving, we're always innovative, and we're always looking ahead, I think.
I think this topic to maintain and develop, maintain the things we already developed and develop furthermore, the things we should have or we could have or we kind of explored how good they would work if we would have them, leads actually to my last question to you both. What is your hope if we look to the future of the next 2 or 3 years, kind of what the data exchanged and between countries, especially in Europe and countries close to Europe, let's call it like that, could do, and what would be helping there for the healthcare system in every country, and also in maybe in the European country plus the European friends countries, let's say like that. So maybe we say in Sweden again.
Well, we are very much hoping for the European health data space. I think it's very important that we should share data. The data is the new gold, as people say it sometimes. And it's so important with this data to solve difficult diseases, which we do not know how to handle now. Try to work more predictive, try to have more precision medicine, for example. I mean, there are so many different kind of ways to use this data, but it's very, very important that people trust in this, because otherwise we get bias in the data. Some people do not want to share it, and then the data is not representative. So I think we should do this very carefully, and also work with communicating with our citizens to explain for them why it's very important to share data, so that they don't choose opt out instead, and also try to use as much as data that is, for example, anonymized or so. You don't have to have personal data for a lot of things. But we are very much hoping for the European health data space and working actively together with other European countries to get it in place. And I know that Germany is very active as well.
I think 2024 it should be in place or should be there. So we were looking forward to that. So as Israel is not a part of the European Union, but actually I think you watch the development closely. What's going on here?
Yeah. I think as mentioned before, I think first of all utilizing data is a major thing, but not only utilizing but sharing it and connecting it with different. And it's not only health, but also social and also geographical and many other elements that are in need in order to determine different things and different understanding. And I think that the interoperability between organizations, between countries, between different fields are one of the most important things that we need to create and to elaborate further on within the country and also between different countries. I think the data sphere that was mentioned, I think it's one of the is a very good idea that I'm very hopeful to see how it's gonna turn out at the end. I think we need to create ways to utilize the data while balancing the different rights of the person and the private personnel, their privacy, the utilization, their own agendas, which are perfectly understandable, and we need to take that in consideration. But we have to utilize the data as a country, as an organization, as a person, and we can do a lot of things with it. Again, personalized, preventive, and many other ways to create it. And maybe the biggest understanding is that it's not just a question of can, but it's a question of must. We must utilize the data. If we don't need to, yes, anonymous data is good, mainly for research purposes, mainly for secondary usage of the data. Most of the times for primary use for the individual itself, we have no choice but to utilize. And of course, again, for a global next pandemic, it's the public health. And there's no other way but to utilize the data itself, and we have to utilize it with AI, with cloud, with EHR, with HIEs, and many other issues that has to be evolved and has to be completed. And unfortunately, today we don't really have a coherent health data governance. Regarding privacy, regarding utilization, regarding primary or secondary usage. And I hope that in the next couple of years, we're going to reach that point. We here in Israel, again, a very small country, but we're trying to innovate in those elements, in the governance way, how to utilize health data for secondary usage, how to use cloud, even though you don't have a region in your country, how to transit data between organizations, between different countries, how to utilize AI. Again, that's everyone is talking about how AI is going to impact the healthcare sector. But when you come to the nitty-gritty of it, you see that there are no really clear understanding of how to do it, not in a major scale way. There are a lot of pilots, there are a lot of researchers, but not on a day-to-day basis. And there is a lot of work being done in the OECD, in the G20, in the WHO, in Europe, in the US, in many other countries. But this is something that we as a global world that is now changing, we're going to have to address, I think.
Thank you then very much for this long statement at the end. I think we had the huge discussion about AI before in the afternoon. So and we had a lot of topics today we discussed, and we just discussed now with you. And I think it was really, really nice to have this international aspects here. We had some guests from Austria, and also now we have some guests from Sweden and Israel. Great. Thank you for sharing your experience with us and for giving us those interesting details about how technology and is fighting the pandemic in your countries. Thank you again, and good night or good evening from Berlin here. We will switch to German again. Thank you for your time. Bye-bye.
Bye.